Good evening. Welcome to everyone. Glad that you're here this evening. Glad those that were traveling made it back safely. If you're visiting, we're glad you're here as well. It does look like our number is down just a little bit, and this is the one night of the year more than any other. If someone isn't here on Sunday night, we know where they are. Or at least we think we do, and if they tell us that it was for some other reason, we don't believe them. So anyway, but you have chosen the better part. Let me commend you. In Romans chapter 8, verse 28, Paul wrote, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose." That is a divine promise. Or maybe it would be more accurate to say that it is a word of divine assurance. We have it from God through Paul that whatever happens in our lives, whether good or bad, God is able to make good come from it. It's a verse we know. It's a verse we can possibly quote. It's a verse that intellectually we probably believe, but it's still hard to trust it fully when really bad stuff happens. And we've all gone through the explanations of the parameters of the promise, but it's still good to review them. This verse does not say that all things are good. It doesn't say that all things should be easy for people who have real faith. It doesn't say that all things work together for good to those who understand God. This statement is made by Paul in a passage that deals with the sufferings of life. That is indeed the context. The paragraph starts back in Romans 8, verse 18, when Paul writes, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." The context is that of putting our sufferings in the context of the hope we have in heaven for eternity. In verse 24, he went on and added, "For we were saved in this hope. But hope that is seen is not hope." That means that the focus of our hope should not be for something during our lives on this earth. The more general application is that God is working on a bigger project for our lives. He's working on eternal blessings for everyone who will accept them. And to accomplish that, He allows, and in some cases, He may even cause temporary hardships on earth in order to bring salvation to a greater number in the long run. Hebrews 11, verse 13, is one of several verses in Hebrews 11 that summarizes the basic truth. It says that these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them. As we read the stories of the Old Testament, the expectation of eternal blessings isn't always evident. Take one example among many that we could. Take Abraham, for example. As the story of Abraham is told to us in Genesis, the main focus is, first of all, for Abraham and Sarah to have a son, and then from that son to anticipate that there will eventually be a great nation from their descendants. But beyond all of that was the expectation of even greater blessings yet to come. But we don't really pick up on that strongly as we read it in the Old Testament. Fortunately, the writer of Hebrews clues us in a little bit more clearly. The story of Joseph that we're going to look at this evening fits that model. Through much of his life, we can only guess at what Joseph may have been thinking. As we read his story, we don't get the idea that he endured several life reversals, knowing at the time that he would be rewarded eventually. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't, but we don't know that as we read it. It doesn't actually say that. For much of his life, we don't even know how consciously he thought about what God might have in mind for him. But before the story ends, we know that he had figured out the basic idea that God was working on the bigger project. As we've seen with a couple other characters in Genesis, we have a lot of material about Joseph in the book of Genesis. Abraham's story runs from chapters 12 to 25, so we have a good big chunk about Abraham. Isaac is the one that gets relatively little attention. He is the main character only in chapter 26. Right after the death of his father. Jacob comes on strong in chapter 27 and continues as the dominant character down through chapter 36. And then Joseph comes to the front of the stage and stays there till the end of the book. His birth is recorded in Genesis 30. He is mentioned a couple of times briefly in chapters 33 and 35. But then from chapter 37 clear to 50, the story of what God was doing then is told through the story in the life of Joseph. The story of Joseph begins as the continuation of the family story of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We looked at Jacob and Esau in a previous lesson. We noted the dysfunction in the family. Both Isaac and Rebekah had favorite sons, and they were not the same sons. Rebekah favored Jacob, Isaac favored Esau. And the favoritism was much more than just giving Jacob a later curfew on Friday nights than they gave to Esau. The favoritism in this case led to major schemes and deceptions that created life-threatening hostility. Jacob, on his end, seems then to have followed the same parenting model as his parents. Jacob, we know, had two wives. Whether he wanted them or not, he had them. He was tricked into marrying Leah. Then he married Rachel out of love. He ended up having children by both Leah and Rachel, plus two of the family servants. He had six sons by Leah and two sons each by each of the other three women. Joseph was son number 11. But because he was the firstborn son of the favorite wife, Rachel, Joseph immediately became the favorite son of his father, Isaac. At least, unlike his parents in this case, he and his wife probably had the same favorite son, but it still didn't sit well with his siblings. As the undisputed favorite son in the family, Joseph seems to have fully enjoyed his role. He was known as the tattletale of the family. If he could bring a bad report to their father about something his brothers had done, he did it. He didn't miss the opportunity. And of course, he received the famous coat of many collars from his father. And this was more than just a slightly nicer birthday gift than his brothers got. In antiquity, a fine piece of clothing was a major, significant gift. Part of a family treasure was the fine clothing that went beyond the normal daily wear. Just as an example of that, in 2 Kings chapter 7, we have a little story. God miraculously killed the Syrian army who had surrounded the city of Samaria during the days of Elisha the prophet. Not knowing that God had already killed the enemy, four lepers from Samaria slipped out and went into the Syrian camp intending to surrender rather than die of starvation during the siege. But they got into the camp of the Syrians and found that everyone was dead. So they loaded up on plunder. 2 Kings 7 and verse 8 says, "They went into one tent and ate and drank and carried from it silver and gold and clothing." Fine clothing was a treasure on the same level with silver and gold. So that helps us understand the significance of Joseph's coat of many colors. So when Jacob gave Joseph that coat, it was something of great value, both symbolically and literally. As a result of the favoritism, Joseph's brothers hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. This was more than he touched me, he breathed on me, he looked at me, you know, the sibling thing. As later events will confirm, when it says they hated him, that wasn't hyperbole. They hated him. Joseph was 17 years old at the time. The brothers would have been in their early to late 20s. Genesis 37, verse 4, but when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Then Joseph made things worse. He had dreams that eventually turned out to be prophetic. The dreams indicated that the day would come when his family, and especially his brothers, would bow down before him. He seems to have found it particularly enjoyable to share his dreams with the rest of the family. Even his father thought that he was being pretentious. And if his doting father thought that, the reaction of his brothers was even worse. In chapter 37, verse 8, it goes on to say, they hated him even more. The trials and tribulations of the life of Joseph began when his brothers had an opportunity to teach their snotty little brother a lesson that he would never forget. They were out in the fields taking care of the flocks, far from the family home. Joseph, as the favorite son, seems to have been spared the task of having to tend sheep out in the open in the hot sun and things like that. But he was occasionally sent out to check up on his brothers, another occasion to bring back bad reports to their father. So his father sent him to check up on his brothers, and they saw an opportunity to get rid of him. They saw him coming and hastily devised a plan to kill him. They would simply tell their father that a wild animal had killed him. Fortunately, the oldest son, that was Reuben, assumed some of the responsibility of an oldest son and devised a plan whereby Joseph would not be killed, but he would still be taught a lesson. Reuben convinced his brothers to put Joseph down in a pit. He intended to come back later and pull him out. So they put him down in the pit, but while Reuben was away, they changed the plan. A caravan of Ishmaelite traders came by, and another son, this time Judah, had the great idea of selling Joseph as a slave to the Ishmaelites. So they sold him to the Ishmaelites, who were headed to Egypt. So in short order, Joseph had gone from favorite and pampered son to being a slave, possibly with a chain around his neck, making a long walk to Egypt. The trials and tribulations of Joseph had just begun. There's a brief interlude in the Genesis account in chapter 38 that doesn't deal directly with Joseph, but then it resumes with Joseph being in Egypt in Genesis chapter 39. Taken to Egypt by the slave traders, Joseph was purchased by a captain of the royal guard named Potiphar. And here is where we start to see the real purpose of Joseph's story. Back when Joseph had the prophetic dreams, for example, we would assume that the dreams were God-given. That's implied in the story, but it's never stated outright. No direct mention is made of God or the Lord in Genesis 37 when it's telling us about his dreams. But we assume that they were from God. Probably correctly. Won't question it. But when Joseph is purchased by Potiphar and climbs from young slave to most trusted servant, we are told explicitly that the Lord, that is Yahweh, was behind his success. Chapter 39, verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. We don't know how long the trip from his homeland down to Egypt with the slave traders. We don't know how long that trip had taken. But every day must have been a horrible, demoralizing, lonely experience for a 17-year-old young man. But that was the road that God chose to get Joseph from spoiled son to manager of the business affairs of a prominent Egyptian official. And when we read that God was the one making Joseph successful, that is a commentary by the writer Moses. That's what Moses writes. That isn't necessarily anything that Joseph was aware of at the time. That's Moses writing in retrospect. But there was a problem in Potiphar's house. Potiphar's wife was a cougar. She had her eye on Joseph, repeatedly tried to seduce him, and just as often he rejected her advances. And this is where, for the first time, we see clear evidence that Joseph had some degree of awareness that God was involved in some way in his life. In resisting the advances of Mrs. Potiphar, Joseph gave her two reasons for not accepting her advances. One was that would be a betrayal of Potiphar's trust when he entrusted running of his household to Joseph. The second reason was, he says, how then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Chapter 39, verse 9. So we see clearly at this point that Joseph was aware of God and recognized the importance of obeying God. First time we have that stated by Joseph. But it's also most interesting. Joseph is aware of what wickedness is. He knows that fornication is a sin against God. But this is centuries prior to the Ten Commandments and thou shalt not commit adultery. Somehow, God had made his moral laws known well in advance of the Ten Commandments, even back in the days of Joseph. So earlier, he may have been an obnoxious younger brother, but at this point, he is definitely a young man devoted to serving God faithfully. Finally, Mrs. Potiphar got tired of being rejected, and she accused Joseph of attempted rape. Her husband chose to believe her, had Joseph put in the royal dungeon. His life had already been shattered when he was 17 and his brothers sold him as a slave. He was just then beginning to overcome that horrible setback. But now things were suddenly worse than ever. It was bad enough being a slave. Now he was a slave in a dungeon. He had been knocked down once again. Joseph had rebuilt his life once, and now he started to do it again. As he had become a trusted servant in Potiphar's house, he now becomes the most trusted of the prisoners. The prison keeper put Joseph in charge of running the place. We know that this was a work of God. In chapter 39, verses 21 and following, "But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy, and he gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners who were in them. Who were in the prison, whatever they did there, it was his doing. The keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority, because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made it prosper." But again, we don't know to what extent Joseph was conscious of God's intervention. We know that it was God intervening. As the story then continues, it's again clear that whatever Joseph understood of God's plan, Joseph remained strong in his faith. Whether he understood exactly what God was doing or not, his faith remained strong. As time went by, two other prisoners, the royal baker and the chief butler, had dreams. Joseph was able to interpret their dreams, and he gave credit to God. In chapter 40, verse 8, they said to him, "We each had a dream, and there is no interpreter of it." So Joseph said to them, "Do not interpretations belong to God? Tell them to me, please." The baker was executed. The butler returned to Pharaoh's service. Joseph asked the butler to remember him and put in a good word that might get him out of jail. We don't know how long Joseph had been in jail, but 2 years later, so whatever that time, plus 2 years, Pharaoh had dreams and needed someone to explain them, and only then, after 2 long years, did the butler remember Joseph. Joseph was called to interpret the dreams, and his faith in and loyalty to God had not diminished in spite of his circumstances. Chapter 41, verse 16, "So Joseph answered Pharaoh, saying, 'It is not in me. God will give Pharaoh an answer of peace.'" We don't know what his attitude was at this time toward his brothers, but he doesn't seem to be at all bitter towards God for the things that had happened to him. Later, he would go on here and interpret Pharaoh's dreams, and after he interpreted Pharaoh's dreams, Joseph is elevated to prime minister, charged with collecting and storing grain in preparation for a great famine. Genesis 41, verse 46 says that he is now 30 years old at the time that occurred. It had been over 13 years since he had been sold by his brothers, and twice in those 13 years his life had been crushed. Now his life seemed to be on the upswing, but it had been a horribly long, rough road. The story then enters the final chapter. After 7 years of abundant harvest, the famine starts. So do the math. It has now been 20 years since Joseph was sold into slavery. When the famine came, his family came to Egypt, where he had been. His family back in Canaan were caught in the famine, and they learned that there was food down in Egypt, so they sent 10 of the sons to Egypt to buy grain. And there they found themselves bowing down to Joseph, even though they weren't aware yet that it was Joseph. The 17-year-old boy had grown up. He had changed. He had aged and changed in 20 years. He had taken on Egyptian fashion, so his brothers didn't recognize him. He even spoke to them through an interpreter. He sold them food, set them up with a charge of stealing, and kept his brother Simeon as a hostage. Eventually, they ran out of grain again, and again they had to go back down to Egypt to buy grain. Joseph had said that they should never come back unless they brought his younger brother Benjamin with them. So he toyed with them a bit. He really made them squirm. We might say that he was getting a little bit of revenge. But then he revealed his identity to them, watched as they feared for their lives. If this was the boy whom they had sold into slavery, what might he do now to settle the score? Now that he had the opportunity. Throughout the story, it has gone unstated just what role Joseph thought God had played in his ups and downs of his life. He seems, though, to have credited God with saving him from the bad situations, but we don't know what role he thought God might have had with getting him into the bad situations. That is, we don't know that until he revealed himself to his brothers. At this point, he realized and stated that God had been in control the whole time. And he seems to have accepted that even the slavery and the dungeon were within God's control to accomplish a greater good. And he was okay with that. Genesis 45 says, verses 4 through 8, not reading the whole passage, but those four verses. "And Joseph said to his brothers, 'Please come near to me.' So they came near. Then he said, 'I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. But now do not therefore be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For these 2 years the famine has been in the land, and there are still 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. And God sent me before you to preserve a posterity for you in the earth and to save your lives by great deliverance. So now it was not you who sent me here, but God. And he has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. What was Joseph expected to do through this roller coaster of a life? Until the final episode, there is no indication that he understood. We can imagine that he often asked himself the question, why is God letting this happen? We can't know for sure that he ever asked that question, but it's entirely possible. We know only for sure that when his brothers showed up the second time, then he saw clearly what God was doing. So as he explained to his brothers, God had put him in a position literally to save the family from severe hardship, if not starvation. And he was thankful to find himself in that position. And he doesn't seem to be bitter that God had not chosen a more pleasant life journey for him. All that he could reasonably have been expected to do over those 20 plus years was to be faithful and trust God. He refused to sin against God. He refused to let wickedness enter his life. If he had dreamed of someday getting revenge on his brothers, we aren't told of it. But when he had the opportunity to do just that, he forgave them, loved them, provided for them. And that's exactly what we are called to do. He is an example for us. It's not mandatory that we understand what God is doing. Whether we face good times or bad times, we are called to trust Him, to avoid sin, to live faithfully before Him. That certainly isn't easy to do in many circumstances. It certainly wasn't easy to do in Joseph's circumstances, but he did it. And he serves as a great example of faithfulness over the long haul, even when life makes no sense at all. The primary question is always, how can I serve God faithfully in this situation? We don't pick the situations always, but whether in good times or in bad times, that is the most important question. How can I serve God faithfully in this situation, in these circumstances? If you want to respond to the gospel this evening, turning your life over to God's control, accepting where He leads you and being willing to follow Him, but most of all, accepting His offer of forgiveness and salvation, let us know. Let's stand, let's sing.